This is the fourth video in Linear Algebra for Machine Learning series. Last time we discussed about dot products and orthogonalization. In this video, we will discuss about system of linear equations and matrices. Linear algebra was developed to solve systems of linear equations. So it is crucial we understand some basics about solving these linear equations here. We know that real-valued functions of a real variable are typically described by an equation, like f of x equals y. Lines are simple geometric shapes, and so the equations which describe them are also simple. As an example, let's create an equation which describes this linear graph. Note that the x and y coordinates of each point on this line have the same value. For instance, when the value of x is 3, y is also 3. This equality between x and y applies to every point on this line. Therefore, the equation which describes the function represented by this graph is y equals x. This function is said to be linear since its graph is a line in the Cartesian plane. Linear functions are very simple but extremely important in maths. This is not only because natural phenomenon can be modeled by linear equations, but also more complicated functions often appear linear when viewed on a small enough scale. Notice that as we examine smaller and smaller regions of this curve, the graph looks more and more linear. The fact that many functions appear linear on a small scale is the logical basis of branches of mathematics such as calculus. Also, the phrase linear equation takes its origin in this correspondence between lines and equations. A linear equation in two variables is an equation whose solutions form a line. Let's add one more line that represents the equation 2x minus 9. A set of two or more linear equations involving the same set of variables is called a system of linear equations. The intersection point of these lines satisfies both these equations simultaneously. That is, it represents a solution that is common to both these equations. Therefore, this point is the solution for this system of linear equations. In our case, it is very clear from the graph that there exists a solution, that is, the intersection point, and therefore the solution for this system of linear equations is x equals 9 and y equals 9. There are several different mathematical methods which can be used to find the point of intersection of these two graphs. Notice that if you substitute the value of y from the second equation into the first, you now have a linear equation in one variable, which can then be solved to get x equals 9. Substituting x equals 9 in the second equation, we have y equals 9. Therefore, the solution we get is x equals 9 and y equals 9. This way of solving the equation to find their solution is called the substitution method, since we started by substituting the value from one of the equations to another. Let's try another method and subtract equation 2 from equation 1. Again, this eliminates one of the variables and we get this equation in one variable, which can be solved to get x equals 9. And again, substituting this value of x into the second equation, we get y equals 9. This process of solving system of linear equations is known as the Gaussian elimination. Gaussian elimination is a general purpose strategy to solve equations in any number of unknown variables. We just saw when solving a system of linear equations, we first solve for one of the variables in terms of the others, solve this equation, and then back substitute until the entire solution is found. Can every set of equations be solved? The answer is no. Every set of equations cannot be solved. Here are the obvious outliers. First, if the number of unknowns is more than the number of given equations. Suppose you have to solve for x and y when you are given this single equation. Can you do it? No, right? Because we have inadequate information to attempt to solve the problem. Many solutions will satisfy this equation, but we will not be able to narrow down to the precise one. Second, if the given equations are not independent pieces of information. That is, if we have a system of linear equations in two variables and the second equation is a mere scaled version of the other. Let's take an example. If we were to do Gaussian elimination here, then to eliminate x from the second equation, we will subtract 2 times the first equation from the second. To get 0x plus 0y equals 0. Not good. In our attempt to eliminate x, we got rid of y too. We cannot solve for y anymore. This happened because the second equation, although seemingly different, conveys the same information as the first one. It is not an independent piece of information. What if we had more than 2, say n, equations in n unknown variables? I hope you guessed it right. To be able to solve equations in n unknown variables, you need exactly n independent and consistent equations. Now that we understand how to solve linear equations, how about we come up with a compact representation for the equations? Note that a linear equation such as 2x1 plus 3x2 equals 5 can also be written in the form of a vector dot product that I discussed in the last video. Here, A is a vector containing the constant coefficients 2 and 3. Also, x is another vector containing the variables x1 and x2. And y is the result, that is y equals 5. So, the equation can be given by A dot x equals y. You can verify that this vector dot product representation represents that single equation. Now that we have a concise representation for a single equation as a vector, how about we come up with a composite representation over multiple vectors? Let's stack the coefficients from each equation as vector. If you remember, we discussed a similar container in the very first video of this series. This composite representation of multiple vectors is known as a matrix. So, now that the vectors of the coefficients have been stacked, how about the vector of unknowns and outputs? Easy. We define a new operation on the matrix, the so-called matrix multiplication. If we refer to the matrix by the symbol A and the vector of the variables by x and the vector of results by y, then A times x equals y represents all these equations. How cool is that? Matrix multiplication works by taking a row from the matrix A, say Ai, and performing a dot product of Ai with the column vector x of unknowns to arrive at the answer Yi. Doing so over all the rows of the matrix leads to m outputs, thereby creating our output vector y. It should be noted that the number of results in y is the same as the number of rows of A. Gaussian elimination can be easily re-implemented for matrices as simple row operations. Multiply a row with an appropriate scalar and subtract it from another row to eliminate a variable and continue to the solution as I demonstrated earlier. What if we had m equations in n variables? I hope you can see that we can still use this same representation. Also, what about the independence requirements that we figured out earlier? Well, they still apply, more succinctly so. To solve equations in n variables, you need n linearly independent rows and n linearly independent columns in the matrix A. This common number of independent rows or columns is simply referred to as the rank of the matrix. Empty matrices have zero rank, and the maximum possible rank of a matrix is less than the lesser of the number of columns or rows of that matrix. The matrix is said to be full rank if it has the maximum achievable rank for a matrix of its size, limited only by the number of rows or columns. In other words, a full rank matrix has its rank equal to its number of rows and number of columns. In our case, A is a full rank matrix and the rank of A is 3. Some matrix operations and theory apply to special type of matrices. Also, there is a concept of good and bad matrices from the perspective of computation, which is important to understand for machine learning engineers and researchers. So, it is good to be aware of these special type of matrices. A square matrix is one with an equal number of rows and columns. A small note about this illustration of a matrix that I have used here. If you assume each colored box in this grid of boxes represent a single element in a matrix, you can see that we have 5 elements in the row and 5 in the column. I'll use this same interpretation for matrices in this section. A white colored box will represent 0 and the colored boxes represent some real number. Matrices with unequal rows and columns are known as rectangular matrices. A symmetric matrix is one with the exact same entries on either side of the main diagonal. That means A is symmetric if and only if Aij equals Aji. Needless to say, a matrix is symmetric only if it is also square. A diagonal matrix is a square symmetric matrix, one with non-zero elements along the main diagonal and zero elsewhere. Remember that the white boxes represent zeros. An identity matrix is a diagonal matrix that has ones along the main diagonal and zeros everywhere else. An upper triangular matrix is one which has non-zero elements along the main diagonal and above the main diagonal. All other elements are zero. Conversely, a lower triangular matrix is one which has zeros above the main diagonal and non-zero elements elsewhere. A matrix with mutually orthonormal rows and columns is known as an orthogonal matrix. In our last video, we have already seen that these vectors are orthonormal, so I'm using this example. There are also classes of matrices based on their definiteness, a general concept in mathematics for quadratic forms, but we don't need to dive deep into the details today. We will discuss if required maybe in some other video, but you need to understand the transpose of a matrix before we classify matrices by their definiteness. The transpose of a matrix is an operator which flips a matrix over its diagonal. That is, it switches the row and column indices of the matrix A by producing another matrix. The T over the matrix represents the transpose operation. Note that the elements in the first column of A now represent the first row of the transposed matrix. And similarly, the second row represents the second column. Let's see another example. Let's transpose this 3x3 matrix. Notice how the rows and columns have transformed. A square symmetric matrix A is called positive definite if X transpose times A times X is greater than 0. Semi-positive definite if X transpose times A times X is greater than equal 0. Negative definite if X transpose times A times X is less than 0. Semi-negative definite if X transpose times A times X is less than equal 0. So that is it for today. In our next video, we will see about the matrix geometry, and that is the most important video in this series. If there is one concept that will make all of the linear algebra easy for you, that is how well you understand this subject depends on how well you understand matrix transformations. So make sure to watch the next video. Thanks for your time. Have a nice day.